welcome to Single and Full. Well, it's Hope Sweden, and I just want to specially welcome you. Amazing how the month is running already. So this is Hope Sweden, and this is Single and Full. Well, it's that wholesome program where we truly, truly look at how to truly be single and how truly being single can add a lot of value to your life. And with me in the studio today is Dave. Dave was here at the last episode, and he's right here again today. And we'll be looking at the original plan. You know that creation has a story, right? Yeah. And there's a reason why God made you and I. And not just being single and married, not just being single and full, not just being single and single. There's a real reason, an original plan that God has for you and I. Well, after the short break, we will unravel all that plan for you.
We will stand in awe of the one who breaks the chains. Love has a name, love has a name, Jesus. Love has a name, love has a name, Jesus.
Great one. Love has a name. Victory has a name. That name is Jesus. Amazing song right there. Well, yeah, like I said earlier, we're looking at the original plan. Dave, do you know that this got me thinking how we can get so busy and we forget the real deal? There's a real plan, you know, there's a real reason why God made man. If you look at the story in creation in Genesis, you see that God wanted that companionship. God wanted that union. God wanted that, you know, that togetherness with humans or with a man. With a man, so basically that's it. So that's the original plan. God wants that togetherness with us. But before we delve into all of that, I'd like to ask you, Dave, when you saw the original plan, what came to your mind?
You know, when I saw the original plan, right, it got me thinking, right?
Okay.
It got me thinking, you know, it's like revisiting what one has known, right? It's like doing a revision, like going back. Right. So there's a lot around the original plan.
Glory to God.
You know, there's a lot around the original plan. God, what God had in mind for man was heavy. Right. Right, in the fellowship, right, was a whole lot, right, than how them just talking and talking and talking. No, in those conversations, right, was meant to be an unveilings, right, that would lead to a lot of productivity, right. So God wanted, so God had a lot of productivity
in mind,
right. Hence why, even after the fall, and Scripture says he repented God that he made man, God could not forsake that plan, because that plan predates the fall. That plan even predates creation, right? Because there was a plan before creation started. Because God, the man cannot be wiser than God in that sense, right? So God had a plan before the creation of man. Right, before God even created the heavens and the earth, it is the plan that God had that birthed
all of that.
All of that.
Glory to God. Yeah.
So the original plan is broad.
It's broad. Yeah.
It's broad. Right.
So let's narrow it a little bit today.
So by the help of the Spirit, we are going to do as much as we can. Right.
Yeah. To during do justice this little to time. It. Right? Amazing. Thank you so much. So what do you think can be the reason? The reason, core reason why God created man or humans.
Right. Just like we said, right, it's broad, right? The scriptures is not like, you know, because we have our perspectives, right? Our convictions, right, are from the scriptures, not just every you know, there's a lot out
going
there,
out there, yes.
Right. There's a lot of concept, a lot of belief,
philosophy.
A lot of, right. So but our belief, right, our convictions,
strong,
right, our stand are from the scriptures, right, are from the word of God, right, which the scripture also says, which liveth and abideth forever, right. So the reason for man, right, as we can see, is it's based on the plan God had, right? Okay. Like I said, it's a backdrop of the plan
yes.
God had, right? Mm-hmm. God was, the scripture says that God alone dwelt in light,
mm-hmm.
right? So God existed, God alone dwelt in light.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
So as a result of that, God wanted that light to be expressed.
Okay. Right? So through someone.
So God wanted that light, mm-hmm. that who alone dwelt in light.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Right? So God wanted that light mm-hmm. to be expressed.
Yeah.
Many lights. You know,
birth it.
You understand? So mm-hmm. God wanted that light. God wanted to express that light. It's like God was full of himself.
Yes.
Right? So God wanted that light
to be dispensed expressed. Through all the channels.
In fact, the scripture says that to the intent that the many-sided wisdom of God.
Mm-hmm.
So you can say the many-sided light of God.
Mm-hmm.
Right? So the reason for man is for the expression of that many-sided light of God.
Hallelujah.
Right? It's for the light of God to be expressed. Right? That God, that godness, that, you know, that fullness.
Yes.
You know, that he is, right, to be expressed. So
amazing.
Basically.
So like David has rightly said, it's for that light that God is already dwelling in, that
yeah.
he is.
Yeah.
He wants it to be expressed through many more people.
Yeah.
Yeah. So to be dispensed. So you yeah. can see how special you are.
Hmm.
In the original plan of God is God in himself
yeah.
thinking for you before you right. even arrived,
oh,
you know,
gosh.
Looking at how you can express him
yeah.
on earth
yeah.
in different dimensions
yeah.
and different, you know, different ways
yeah.
and it really comes to that point where people can think, not just being single and being married
yeah.
not just being single and being single
yeah.
or
yeah.
single
yeah.
and unmarried
yeah.
but
yeah.
being
yeah.
single and being focused mm. on knowing that thing
mm. yeah.
what's the reason why yeah. God yeah. made
yeah.
me
yeah.
why am I here yeah. yeah, single and full is about purpose. It's about you discovering that reason why God created you
mm.
honestly. If you do life only, you know, based on just having a family and just having children
mm.
and just growing old and dying, well
yeah.
that's a plan, but I don't think that's the original plan
mm.
yeah, that's a plan, right, Dave?
Yeah,
but that's not the original plan.
Yeah.
The original plan includes that and a lot more
mm.
do you understand? God
yeah.
is about family
yeah.
so that family you're even craving to have
yeah.
is God's idea.
Yeah, yeah,
it's God's
yeah,
idea.
Yeah,
he started
yeah,
that way, right?
Yeah,
in
yeah,
creation,
yeah.
it was family that
yeah,
was on his mind.
Yeah.
You know, there's a book E.W. Kenyon wrote. He said, "The Father and His Family," something
yeah,
like
yeah,
that.
Yeah,
yeah?
And family, yeah,
exactly. So God is about family.
Yeah.
So the family you're craving to have
mm.
as a single person or as an unmarried person mm. is a type of what God is looking at.
Mm.
Yeah, basically. So
mm.
there's a big plan God is unfolding, and today
mm.
we're going to attempt to look at the original plan.
Mm.
Well, back to David. What do you think Revelations 2:4-5? Now that particular church got me thinking, you know.
Yeah.
Yeah. So that scripture, what do you think Revelations 2:4-5 was referring to with emphasis on first love?
Right.
He said there's something I have against you, you
yeah.
know, that you left your first love.
Yeah.
Let's talk about that a bit.
Yeah, so this was to the church.
Hmm.
Right. This was to the church, right? And this was to the church that, you know, had a foundation, right? Because the Lord could not have been saying this if there was not a backdrop of foundational understanding.
Yes.
Just like to the first man, you know, before God could say, "Have you eaten of the tree of the knowledge and good?"
Yes.
It means there was a backdrop, there was an interaction.
Yes, yes.
Certain foundations had been laid.
Laid, yes.
Right? You know,
before that conversation,
before that, you know, mm-hmm. because the Lord was saying, "I have somewhat against you."
Yeah.
Right.
Mm-hmm.
It means this is not according to the plan.
Yes.
This
there's
not,
an original plan.
This is not according
yeah.
to the plan,
mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
which I have, you know, I have through, you know, in the light of scriptures, through the ministry gifts
mm-hmm.
brought you to the light
mm-hmm.
of.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm,
right,
mm-hmm.
And it is obvious that you are not walking according to that light.
Original plan, yes.
So you are not walking according to that light.
Mm-hmm.
So in Revelations, you know, for the Lord had to call that church to order.
Yes,
because you can see that in also the backdrop.
Yes,
not just, you know, this particular church.
Yes,
he was.
Yeah, all the churches,
you know,
he was addressing.
Standing in the midst
mm-hmm.
of the candlestick,
mm-hmm.
so he was calling the church to order.
Yes,
you know. And you see, he says to the angel, right? And, you know, in the light of scriptures, which we may be able to go into details, you know, in this context, when he talked about angel, he was actually speaking to the ministry gifts.
Sure, sure. We know that.
Right?
Yeah.
So, he was actually speaking to the ministry gifts. Yes. It is through the ministry gifts that the Lord perfects his church.
Yes.
He brings his church to order.
Yes, totally.
Right? So, thou hast left thy first love. Mm-hmm. Right? That the original plan.
Yes.
Like basically the original plan of fellowship, and as a result of fellowship, what you are meant to be doing,
you are not doing it,
right? So as a result of fellowship, you are meant to be there are purposes, right? And basically the earth is meant to be subdued, the earth is meant to be filled with the knowledge of the glory of God.
Yeah.
And not just knowledge as per knowledge, the experience.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
And that's what God is counting on the church today to do,
right? Well, yeah.
Whether married or unmarried, like we looked at last week, right? Being single, both when you are married and full.
Yes.
Full of the light of God,
full of
the purpose of God,
yes.
Full of the counsel of God.
Yes.
Right? So the earth, people experiencing the glory of God.
Yes.
Much more than death. Right, a lot of death is happening, not just in physical bodies, right? Not just in physical bodies, but in experience.
In experience. Now talking about death, do you know that no matter how brand new a car is, if you park that car and you do nothing with that car, it will decay.
Yeah.
Everything in this world is in decay form.
Yeah. Yeah.
You see why it's so, I don't know, I would say useless to think just on things you see. To live your life and build it on just the temporal things you can see.
Yeah.
It's such a vague life to live, you know. So there's much more to your life, single out there. Yeah. There's much more to your life, being unmarried. There's much more to your life, and it's bigger than what you can see. Honestly, there's more to your life than meets the eye.
Yeah.
So let's continue, Dave.
Yeah.
You were talking about that church, yeah?
Yeah. So like you see in verse 5, it says, "Remember therefore from whence thou art fallen and repent."
Mm-hmm.
Right, so and do the first works.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm,
right, this was to a church that had a foundation.
Yeah,
you know, the Lord could not have been bringing this to their notice if there was not an existing foundation.
And you know the thing I like about this church. Now this church, they ticked the boxes.
Yeah,
in many other things.
Yeah,
now
yeah.
But he came to this one and said. Yeah. I'm finding you wanting in this particular.
Right.
So it means that this one is so important to him.
Yeah. Yeah.
Yeah? So talking about first love, we can now look at it in details. Now let's look at it.
Yeah.
If he said you've erred because you've left your first love and you've established, we've established that it is fellowship.
Yeah.
It is communion.
Yeah.
Why do you think this was so important to God, Dave?
Yeah, this was so important because it is via communion that we are able to effectively carry out the purposes and plans of God.
Great.
If not, you will just be doing your own thing.
Mm-hmm.
You'll just be doing your own thing.
Which brings us to that point where people can wake up and you just have your plans, yeah? And you tell God, bless my plans for
me.
You know, and honestly, he's not looking at that thing because you've actually deviated from the actual plan.
Yeah.
You see how important it is for you to wake up every morning and you're like, Father, what would you have me do? See, these plans are here, but honestly, I want your counsel to stand in my life.
Yeah, yeah.
Jesus lived for just 33 years,
yeah.
Did amazing work for just 3 years,
awesome.
And generations to come, we cannot finish talking about his work within 3 years only.
Yeah,
just 3 years.
Yeah.
And you've lived like 60, 40, 30, 20, 80, 90, and maybe you're approaching 100, and you're still wondering every day what you did with your life. You see, it's because you have lived, and honestly, you've not made that thing, you know, that commitment to just say, Father, I really want to know what your plan is for me. Dave, I've come to know that in purpose is everything.
Yeah.
You see that money you're running after? Honestly, if you discover that purpose, that money will look for you.
Yeah,
I can tell you the truth.
Yeah, yeah.
Everything you're running after will look for you.
Mm.
And you will see the essence of that scripture in Matthew 6, It should be 30. Yeah. Matthew 6:30. Is it 33 or 30? Is it seek ye first the kingdom of God and his 33. Seek ye first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and every other thing will be added, unto you.
Yeah.
So we look for the additions, the husband, the car, the children, the this, and we leave the kingdom. We leave the kingdom that is within us. And that kingdom, like David has said, looking at that scripture, see, that kingdom cannot even be birthed if you don't have that communication line with the Father. That communion is everything. Having to speak with him and he speaks to you, so it's not dialogue, but it's not monologue. It's dialogue, because you're speaking to him. He's your Father, and he now he's speaking to you. And one of the perfect ways that we'll be looking at that God communicates with us is through his word. God will not do anything outside his word. His word is him. So if you have his word, you have everything that he wants you to do. So Dave, you want to say so something more on that?
You know, like we're looking at, right? You know, it's so important that a lot of persons understand this, because many times when we talk about the kingdom, it looks like it's just one vague side.
It's
just one narrative, right? It's the kingdom is the wisdom of God.
The wisdom of God, yes.
Right? It's the wisdom of God, like we're saying now, which is the original plan
of God,
which is not a disconnect, because when we talk about kingdom, it's actually an active connection, right, with the divine.
Yes,
because sometimes when we say God, it just looks God. No, an active connection with the invisible
God. Yeah,
right. Because in fact, according to the original plan, God was not meant to be invisible, right? God being invisible to man is as a result of
the, I get that,
right? The kingdom of God seemingly being invisible is as a result of the fall,
because if you remember at the garden, he was always coming in to stay with them, and they could see him.
So there was an actual interaction with God, right? There was an unveiling. In fact God's plan was that as a result of man feeding, eating, right, of the tree of life, the tree of life, basically, right, if you do a deep study, the tree of life actually was the reality of God. The tree of life was the reality of God, was the government of God.
Okay.
Right, that man was meant to keep eating off.
Okay.
Eating off. And as a result of eating, his eyes, his heart, sight, you know, sight, like he was meant to grow in sight by eating.
By that
interaction with the tree of life.
So bringing it home now, today, what is that eating that can happen?
Fellowship. Which is the core.
And that fellowship can begin from where? From God's word, right?
Yes, from God's word.
Amazing,
right? Because, you know, like we're looking at a lot of these things has not been clearly communicated to believers. So, you know, after I got saved, in fact, these were some of my burning passions, because I began to see something opposite to what I began to look in the scriptures, right? Because I saw, people get saved with a lot of, you know, responsibility. They want to begin to do a lot of stuff for God. As good as that is, I began to realize that's not the call. It's not the call.
Great one.
Even as good as it may seem, saved to save others. As good as that is, which is fundamental, a fundamental part of the Christian faith.
Sure.
No, that's not the primary.
Okay.
You are saved first for relationship with
Glory
God.
To God. Now I like this, because this brings us to eternal life. You know, if you look at John 17, Jesus said eternal life, that they might know you, the only true God, and Jesus his son. Now eternal life is knowing God. What it is. That brings us to that point. Exactly what you're saying, that everything God is unveiling is for you to have that communication, to have that knowing him is what God is looking for. See, you can't even do anything without that fellowship.
Honestly, in
this world, hey God, if you don't take time to be intentional about knowing God for yourself, you will be swept.
Okay.
I can tell you that, because everything is calling for your attention. You will just see yourself going like a roller coaster, and you just don't know when you're stopping. And when you now land, you're like, what have I done with my life? is a sad state to be in. I can tell you that.
Yes.
So being single is that time where your eyes, that eye of yours is single. I want to know why I'm here.
Okay.
David, this is what wakes me up every day.
Yeah.
I can tell you the truth.
Yeah.
This is what wakes me up. Like every day I wake up, Father, what would you have me do today?
Yeah,
like I value that time of just asking, just knowing, just learning of him, just being
coming
around people.
Light.
Yeah, coming into light. Being around people who are passionate about him. Yeah, because you're single and all you have around you are people who want to party, people who want to just jive, people who want to slay. As you're slaying the queen and slaying the king, I'd like to just advise you to look into God's word.
Yeah,
I can tell you the truth. If you do nothing in this world about taking responsibility about your purpose, honestly, you would not like the way your life would turn out. I can tell you that. It's not about getting married. You can get married, but because your life was not truly single, that marriage will not work. I can tell you the truth. It will not, because a marriage that is standing on a false foundation cannot stand. It's just the way it works. So stay on God's word, but let's not even go ahead of ourselves. Let's go to the next one. So if there's a first love, could there be a second love, third love, foot love? Let's talk about that. You know, looking at that scripture in Revelations 2.
Yeah, you know, like we said, if, you know, basically like Jesus was saying, Jesus was calling their attention, right? It means, you know, certain other things had taken
their attention,
right? Priority, just like we looked at last week, right? Because this life of communion, of growing in light.
Yes.
Because the scripture says that we be no more babes, right?
When you're supposed to be teachers now.
That's for every believer.
Yes, yes, yes.
Both married and unmarried.
Unmarried.
Right, which is growing in light.
Yes, growing in the knowledge of the truth.
Growing in light.
Yes.
Growing in sight.
Yes.
The scripture also says that we as lively stones are being built.
Yes.
A holy habitation for God.
Yes.
Right. Which is what E.W. Kenyon and Kenneth Hagin talked about, the vital side of our redemption.
Yes, yes. We have the legal part and the vital.
Right, which is us putting on Christ.
Yes. And having the true experience of Christ.
Do you understand?
Yes.
Which is what Paul began to say, that the eyes of your heart be enlightened.
Yes.
That you may know.
Yes, Ephesians 1.
That the knowing, yes, that you may experience.
Experience.
Because this was to saints.
Yes.
It says, since I heard of your faith in the Lord Jesus.
Yes.
So this was to believers.
Yes.
And this was to the church in Ephesus.
Mm-hmm.
Both married and singles.
Yeah.
In quotes, right?
Yes, yes.
So this was to the church that the eyes... It says, since I heard of your faith in the Lord Jesus, cease not to give thanks.
Yes, yes.
Like, that's the starting point. Thank you, Jesus.
Yes.
I'm saved. I'm the believing one.
Yes.
But there's still understand. There's a journey.
Yes.
Right.
Yes.
Since I heard of your faith in the Lord Jesus,
yes,
cease not to make mention of you in my prayers.
Mm-hmm.
Right. That the eyes of your heart be enlightened.
Amazing.
That you may know, that you may experience.
Mm-hmm.
The knowing is not just the Bible says no. An experience.
Yes.
A heart experience.
Yes, of God. Yeah. Yeah.
Of God. In fact, the scripture says that it says that fight the good fight of faith. In fact, that's the fight. It's not fighting with devils.
I get you.
In that sense.
Yes.
The fight, it says, fight the good fight of faith. Lay hold
on eternal life.
So it means these things can be held.
Yes.
They can be understood.
Yes.
Right?
Yes. Yes.
So the first love is growing in light.
Glory to God.
Growing in light. As a result, the purpose of God, there's an advancement in the purpose of God.
Glory to God.
So if there is any other love, any other passion,
it
means that something else has taken the place.
Glory.
And it could be more than one thing. Many times for many people.
You know,
it could be more. And it's not like God has any problem with expressions of creativity.
No.
But it must be a backdrop of the core.
Of the core,
Of the core.
Which is knowing him.
And it's not religion.
Mm-hmm.
It's
mm-hmm.
not just you know, you have to do the work of God.
Mm-hmm.
What I do? No. It's gracious.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
It's gracious.
Mm-hmm.
That's why it's meant to flow from communion.
Yeah. So you can understand.
You understand. So it's not just a legalistic work. Oh, if you don't do the work of God, God will punish you. No,
mm-hmm.
no, 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 no.
or you're not bearing fruit.
Do you understand? No, mm-hmm. no, no. Mm-hmm. It says that by faith we have access into this grace.
Yes.
Wherein we stand.
Yes. Yes.
Rejoicing. Yes. It's yes. not just, it's not in fear, mm-mm. as far. No, no, no. Mm-mm. We have access into this grace.
We already have this love established.
Do you understand?
His love is established in our hearts, right? Yeah. So I like that part of the fight of faith.
Yeah.
Now the fight of faith.
Hmm.
I like to just talk about that
yeah.
a bit. See, it's not your mother-in-law.
Yeah.
That enemy is not your mother-in-law. Yeah. I can tell you the truth.
Yeah.
That enemy is not your father-in-law.
Yeah.
It's not that boyfriend of yours.
Hmm.
See, we have an adversary.
Hmm.
We know him and he is defeated.
Hmm.
I like to just announce ahead of time that he is defeated.
Hmm.
Now, the fight we're talking about, you're fighting from victory.
Hmm.
Now, let me break it down a bit. Now, in this fight, this is the fight of faith, and that fight is this attention we're talking about. When other things want to take that attention of fellowship, that communion that you should have in your heart always for God, you should fight for that space. Because that space is what births all the inventions.
Mm.
That space is what births all the innovations, all the correct creativity.
Yeah. Yeah,
that will add real value to not just you but generations unborn. Now when you're looking at yourself, I beg you, stop looking at yourself as David or Hope.
Yeah.
See, you look at yourself in the light of God's word. You are a nation. You are a people. I can tell you that. So you know that everything you do is not any single and full. See, it's not just David. It's David in generations. Is David in nations? Is hope in nations? This is so important. So this is why you have to take time to say, Father, I like to know you. Holy Spirit, I want you to teach me who God is. He is available to you. We are saying, the emphasis we're making here is be intentional about your life. Don't live for what you can just see. Don't live just because you want to get married. You get a good degree. You get married. You have children. And then you leave. You make money and you die. My dear, if that's why you came here, I'm sorry. It's better you didn't come. Because that's not what to live for only. God is about all that. But God is more about you fulfilling the purpose for which he created you. And you are more than you can see. You're more than that person you look at the mirror. In fact, the person you see on in that mirror is not you. The person you're looking at in that mirror is not you. Because you're not that beautiful body only. There's so much about you that is bigger than what you're seeing. So that's the emphasis we're laying. That the first love, that church ticked the boxes for many things. But they left their first love. And God is saying, see, the reason why I have you is first for fellowship. If we don't communicate, we can't even know what the plan is. You cannot know what the plan is for you. Jeremiah 29:11, we all like to quote it. For I know the thoughts I have, you know, I know the thoughts I think towards you, thoughts of good and not of evil, or plans of good and not of evil, to give you hope and a future. You need to take that responsibility of getting to know what that plan is. You need to. You need to. Because it's not just you quoting that. There's a plan. And that plan is important. You get to know it. That plan can begin from God's word. We are saying prioritize God's word over every other thing. When the enemy is trying to fight you, making you think it's someone out there that is your enemy. No, you have an adversary. That adversary, you may not see him with your eyes, but he can manifest through anybody around you. He can manifest through your mother, your father, your brothers, your sisters, your friends out there, your mother-in-law, your father-in-law. But those people are not your enemies. I can tell you that. Your enemy is an adversary and he has been defeated. Now, when he shows up to make you leave your place in God, know that it's not those people, is that enemy. He wants to distract you from the original plan. Just like that church ticked all the boxes. You may have ticked all the boxes. Maybe you pay your tithes. Maybe you do all the Sunday school teachings. And maybe you appear before people looking so holy and amazing. But you see, if you leave that place of fellowship, all you're doing is just activities. And honestly, it's not getting you anywhere. When you leave that place of communion and fellowship. Well, this is a lot of talk we've had so far. Let's go for a short music break. And when we come back, we'll talk more on this.
We will stand in awe of the one who breaks the chains. We will lift our eyes to Jesus. We will fix our eyes on the one who
Alright, we're right here, still single and full. Single and Full is that wholesome program that is not just teaching you how to be single and getting married. It's that program that teaches you how to be single and full. Full of God's word, full of purpose, living life every day, really enjoying it, and really, you know, just feeling good about life because you are connected to the one who matters, the one who has loved you with an everlasting love. Do you know that, David, when people even get married, I can tell you, see, your husband will not be telling you I love you 24 hours if you don't rest on this love that is everlasting. My dear, it is finished. Doesn't matter. If you don't rest in this love that is everlasting, even your husband cannot give you all that love that you want. See, he has to even receive that love to give it to you. A man can give you what he doesn't have. I can tell you the truth. For you to even enjoy that marriage, see, your husband has to receive love from love. Your husband has to receive love from love himself. He has to understand God's plan for his life, receive, know how God loves the church, and then that's how he can love you. So it's it moves from there.
It's a chain.
It's a chain. So everything still boils down to this original plan of fellowship, of communion.
Actual interaction.
That's the truth. Actual interaction. Amazing one. So let's move. So humans like to know why they should do a thing, Dave. So what is that thing, or, you know, singles should focus on that will birth a constant heart connection that brings God's, you know, God real pleasure? You know, people like to know, why should I even just have this fellowship? Why? People just want to know, why should I do this? What do you think?
You know, as a result of the fall, right? There was a lot of disorder. You know, you can even
and
see
distortions.
You can even see it in the scripture where, you know, the Bible says, "For she saw." They both saw, right? It was a wisdom. It was a sight that was presented to them that they partook of, and they fell into. Right, man came under, right? So a lot of the experience of life is according to that sight, according to that good and evil, which is not consistent with the original plan. Right, because the original plan is life. The original plan is light.
Is life and is light.
It's light.
It wasn't about good and evil.
God is, in fact, the scripture says that it says, "Hear you, ye, O Israel, that the Lord your God is one."
Yes.
That's what we say when we say you are holy.
Yes.
The Lord your God is one.
Yes. He doesn't change.
God is a God of light. You know, God is light. God is love. Not God is love and hate. Not God is love and darkness.
That's what I mean.
God is love. Love is God.
Yes.
Right? So you need to understand that this fellowship is the original plan.
It's the original plan,
right? Fellowship, interaction, right? Man was designed to interact with the invisible. We could see that even after man fell. There are two positions in the book of Genesis where the Bible says that it says some said that let us build a tower which top reaches to the heavens.
Yeah.
Right? It was a craving.
It is there.
Right? For interaction with the higher realm.
Yes.
Right?
Yes.
Which that which transcends just the visible.
Yes. Yes.
It's
yes.
a craving.
Yes.
Let us build a tower.
Mm-hmm.
Man, which top reaches to the heaven.
Mm-hmm.
Man was reaching out
yes.
to the invisible.
Yes. It's inbuilt there.
It's invisible.
Yes.
You see,
yes.
man was deep down within man wants to experience the supernatural.
Yes.
He may not say supernatural, but man wants to experience no limits.
Yes, yes, yes.
Someone said deep down within man is desire not to die,
yes.
because that is according to the original plan.
Totally. Totally.
So according to deep down within man, they don't want to die. Why? Because that is according
it's just their design.
Original plan.
Yes, the original design, yeah.
So part of the reason for fellowship, right? Actual interaction with God, we start with new birth.
Glory to God.
It starts with new birth, right?
To God,
receiving
yes.
Christ.
Yes.
Not giving your life to Christ. There are two different things.
Yes.
Like
many
people say, I want to give my... No, you can't give your life to Christ. You receive
you
Christ.
You can't even give life you don't
no,
have.
You receive Christ.
Yes.
So the foundation is receiving Christ.
Mm-hmm.
It's receiving light.
Yes.
It's receiving... light, receiving
yes.
life, receiving
yes.
light,
yes.
right? So by receiving life,
mm-hmm.
the eyes of your heart, begins to be enlightened.
Glory to God.
And as a result of your eyes being enlightened, like Paul says, mortality
is swallowed up.
Begins to be swallowed up.
Yes, by immortality, yeah.
The limitations that came with the fall begins to be swallowed up.
Glory to God, yeah. Yeah,
begins
yeah,
to be swallowed
yeah,
up.
Yeah,
in fact, that
yeah,
in fact, that's
yeah.
what Paul was praying,
death,
that we may
death.
Know the hope of our calling.
Death be swallowed up by life.
It is not in a sense evangelism as the primary, because what we are to evangelize is what we have
experienced.
Do you understand?
Yes, yes.
The eyes of our heart are enlightened too. Because what we're going to be telling people, just like has been in the church.
Yes.
Give your life to Christ. It doesn't add up.
In a, yeah.
It
yeah.
doesn't add up.
Yeah.
No, you don't give. You come to receive.
Yes.
It's
yes.
life to the end.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
That's mortality.
It's swallowed up. Yeah. Totally. Totally.
Progressively.
Totally.
The
yeah.
limitations.
Swallowed up.
I'm always tired. I'm always weak. I don't know what to do. Fear. Uncertainty.
Yeah.
In a progressive manner.
Now swallowed up.
Being swallowed up.
Glory to God.
Being
yeah.
swallowed up by life.
Glory to God.
By immortality.
So that tired body.
Yeah.
That tired body gains life.
Yeah.
Now gets to know that there's life.
Yeah.
That quickens the mortal body.
Yeah. Yeah.
So
yeah.
you see. So that tired body gains life.
Yeah. Yeah.
Now that confused mind.
Yeah.
Gains life.
Not knowing what that man that does not know what to do consistently.
Mm-hmm.
Where there's a challenge and I don't know what to do. I don't.
As you expose yourself to the light. To light.
You know what to do.
Glory to God.
Scripture says that we have received an unction,
a
life from the Holy One.
We know
and
what to do.
We know all to. We know how to know
yes,
what
yes.
to do.
Glory to God.
We know how to. Right? We just have to tilt our hearts. Right? Because
Hallelujah.
We've been called to an actual fellowship.
Yes, 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 yes.
You know?
Yes, yes.
We've been called. So I just need to tilt my heart.
And we just know all
we
things.
We just know.
Ah, yeah.
Because the life I've received
Hallelujah.
Is able to know all things.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm,
That's
mm-hmm.
why, in fact, the scripture says that when the Spirit of truth is come, He will guide you into all
yes,
truth.
Yes,
not
yes.
your pastor.
Yes, yes, yes.
No, they have their role.
Yeah.
But it's the presence of the Spirit
yes,
of
yes,
God.
Yes, yes, yes.
And
yes.
the presence of the Spirit of God is what makes us new creations.
Yes.
So that presence puts us in a place where we can know what to do.
Hallelujah.
He says that He will guide us.
Yes, yes, yes.
Into
yes.
all truth.
All
so
truth.
We don't need all this. Pastor, what do you think? What do you think? I just want to know. No, you can know.
You can know. Glory to
you
God.
You can know. Glory to God.
Yes, I like that. So let's look at this. You know, people want to give thanks. For instance, Thanksgiving Sunday. Now all we are thinking about is what God has done for us in the sense of physical things.
Yeah,
like
yeah.
I bought a car this year.
Yeah.
I got married this year.
Yeah.
I had children this year. Now, as good as all that can be, there's a real reason for Thanksgiving. There's a real reason for fellowship. And that is unfolding the redemption plans. Do you know, Dave, when I think about redemption realities, my mind is busting. Hey, where do we even start from?
it's,
look at the covenant.
Yeah.
I had no business with it.
Yeah.
No business.
Mm.
God called a covenant with Christ
mm.
and just made me a beneficiary.
Mm.
And today I can say I'm Abraham's seed.
Yeah.
I can say today that I have rights in the kingdom.
Mm.
I did nothing.
Mm.
I only received it.
Right.
I received what he did for me.
Yeah.
Now, this is the real reason why one can give thanks.
Mm.
That I'm superior to what people are running from, which is the devil.
Yeah.
Yeah. If he shows up here, people are taking their heels or running. I'm bigger than that guy.
He has raised us up.
Yes. Yeah. He has raised us up.
Yeah.
I'm at the level where Christ is seated
at
the right hand of the Father and I can take my position there and this earth can yield her increase to me because I'm above. That's what to thank God for. That's how to that's how to commune with the Father. That's what to think about. And fellowship can be birthed. Communion can happen. And you can enjoy. And people are wondering, why are you happy in this kind of economy? And you are thinking, God, you have no idea. Do you know where I'm seated? Do you know what God has done for me? Do you know my rights, my legal rights in the kingdom? Do you know who I am? Do you know that the devil is afraid of me? Do you know that he doesn't even matter? Do you know that there are territories and kingdoms that I take at different times and different positions because of my communication or communion with the Father? Dave, I'd like you to just throw some light on redemption realities.
All right, like we're saying, right, redemption is not an aftermath, right? It's not a new plan, just like the new creation man. It is, he's not a new man in that sense.
Yes
he's the man God desired from the beginning.
Like
before all things.
Bible
says that having predestinated us, it's a preordination. Having predestined us, it's a preordination.
Now hold your good thoughts. I think it was Colossians. Either Colossians 3:10.
Yeah,
I'm trying to remember.
Ephesians also.
There's one that said, we are complete in Him.
Yeah,
but there's another translation I saw. He said, we have become God's poetry. I think that's the message. We have become God's poetry. A recreated people who will fulfill the destiny he has given to us. He said, for we are joined to Christ even before we were born. God gave us our destiny in advance and the good works we would do to fulfill it. Amazing one. So go ahead, Dave.
So that's what it is, right? It's not just man, like we said, God had a plan for man, for the being called man. If you look through the scriptures, basically, because some people may say, hey, okay, if this is why did Satan come to man? Like we said, the scriptures is not your literature textbook. The scripture is a spiritual book.
It is.
And it doesn't mean you can't relate to it. You can relate to it by the help of the Spirit of God.
Spirit,
So if you read Isaiah, because Moses did not leave a lot of details.
Okay.
The Bible says holy men wrote as they were moved by the Holy Ghost.
Yeah.
So Moses wrote as much as he could write.
Right?
But you see, other men that were moved began to capture, to the measure that they could, right, of how did the earth come to this state? Because even Moses, if you remember, Moses said, show me your glory. The glory of God is not smoke. Show me your glory. God. No. The glory of God, show me your glory. Show me your original plan.
Okay.
Show me, what did you have in mind? Because a lot of what we see is not according to glory. Because you are, because Moses in an interaction with God had come to see a God of light, a God of glory. So he said, if this is what you are, show me your glory. Because much of what is now is not according to your glory.
To the actual plan,
So he said, show me your glory. So the glory of God is that plan which you now begin to see in Isaiah. Lucifer. Lucifer began to have sight into the plan of God for man, which is what the Spirit of God began to help you know, Isaiah to capture, you know, which we may not, you know, it, like the scriptures is broad, but the more we look at it, the more it opens up, right? Which is the reason for redemption, because redemption is God bringing man back
to that original
on track, because God, that's why you see, you know, after that man fell, God did not give up.
Yes.
There was a plan.
Yes.
God is a faith God. Yes. God had a plan. Yes. So God, if people say, if God knew man was going to fall, why did God create man? God did not have any fall plan.
Let's not even go there.
God did not have any fall plan. God had a plan of man growing up into him in all things.
Yes, in all.
Like if you look at Genesis carefully, God says, let us make man. After our image.
Yes.
Genesis and 1 from likeness, verse, you know, yes. Let
verse
us make man.
Then
Genesis 1:27. So God created man. He didn't say so. God made man.
Okay.
Man was not, when God created man, man was not yet in the image and likeness of God in his fullness.
Okay.
That was why man was capable of fall, of falling.
Okay.
Because the scripture says God cannot be tempted with evil.
We'll get there. Now you're shaking some tables and you're getting into some deep matters. Yeah, so, we'll get there. Yeah, because gradually.
Yes, to actually talk about redemption, you have to actually do justice to this foundation.
Yes.
Because many people say, hey, why redemption? It just looks like God is just playing with us.
No.
Why? If God knew we'll fall, God did like God just, you know, man will fall, then God will not save them. Yeah. You know, then people now say, hey, God just created us for his glory. God can just do and undo, you know.
Yeah, so, many parts to that.
So a whole lot. So we can actually, you know, really, you know, really talk about redemption if we don't understand
that original plan.
This original plan.
That something happened to, and then redemption had to happen.
Do you understand?
To bring man into that perfect plan again.
That's that part.
That part.
That
again.
Part of light.
Of light again.
Of journeying in
of
the light.
Journeying in the now that part, which is that bringing man back, I think is something one should be grateful for.
Yeah.
It's something one should be grateful for, and want to know this God that was so kind. Yeah,
that
he's so passionate about them that he had to do all of this to get them back. Yes, to get them back on track.
Yeah, kind. Glory.
Yeah, glory to God. And that's the thing that can birth that fellowship, that wanting to know him.
Inquisitiveness.
Yes. I like to know this God. I like to know
growing
this God.
Right.
Yes, growing in the knowledge of him. And honestly, that's the only way grace can actually, however, is it grace and peace?
Yeah.
It's grace and peace.
Is multiplied. Yes,
can be multiplied, yes. That grace and peace is multiplied to us as we continually journey in knowing him.
Yeah.
In growing in that knowledge.
Yeah,
now
that
knowledge doesn't stop only when you are married.
No.
I can tell you, the bigger journey has begun for you. If you're married, the bigger, because now both of you will have to display to this world how God is loving the church.
Yeah,
yes.
Yeah,
how the church is being submissive. Yes.
Yeah.
Oneness. So even when you're married, you have the bigger responsibility. Of showcasing the oneness of God. Knowing that your husband and you is about a type of what God is saying. That's the truth. It's a type of what God is saying. Displaying
about
his
Christ
relationship
and
the church.
That's
what it is about.
Kai.
So it's not just about me having children, sending them to you. There's a real plan for that marriage. That marriage is supposed to exhibit the oneness of God.
Yeah.
Tell the story
Of
our relationship
like,
with him. Yeah.
Like I you know, sometimes my fellowship with God, like you said, because after I got saved, an inquisitiveness, a hunger.
Yes.
Which is what receiving Christ does.
Does for you.
It
yeah.
makes you hungry.
Yes.
For the supernatural. It reawakens. It's a reawakening.
Glory to God.
Right. So I began to ask. I've seen a lot of people are married next week Saturday. They're going to get. And I began to ask.
Hallelujah.
It's because sometimes you see some people in the church. You say, you know, they are all caught up with. Oh, I've not had children. I'm barren. And it looks like, you know, they are just bound by that whole thing. God has no problem with people having children.
No, not at all.
You know, in my fellowship with God, I just said many of these people, they've not even come to the place in their heart where they know that it's God's will for me to have children and stamp their feet there.
Yes.
That, see, this is what does justice.
And use their authority.
It's just like you knowing God's will for me is prosperity.
Glory to God.
This is the basis of prosperity.
Yes. Yes.
So
yes.
It's the same way you know God's will for me is having children.
Yes.
Within that light, you can even know God wants me to have three children.
Yes. Yes.
And in the name of Jesus Christ,
yes, yes,
I'm
yes.
having three
Glory
children.
To God.
No
yes.
longer.
Yes.
No, 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 no,
it's
no, no,
not,
no,
it's
no.
not God. Is no, it your no. will? No, no, no. no.
If because you, basically, like we're saying, that's not even the core. Many people, many people may even see. Oh, Jesus!
That's what we're saying.
I began to ask the Lord questions, right?
Mm-hmm.
You know, see, people say having children is not the core of marriage.
Ah, yeah.
Oh, Jesus! Having children as, you know, as beautiful as it is, you know, it's not the core.
Yeah, yeah.
It's not
yeah.
the core.
Mm-hmm.
You know, because God says, He says that a woman shall, you know, a man shall leave
yes.
his father and shall be cleaved
yes.
to his wife.
Yes, yes, yes.
Right? For purpose.
Yes, yes, yes.
For purpose.
Yes.
For
yes.
purpose.
Yes.
For purpose. So really, 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 two couples can choose not to have children.
Yes.
It is not against
it's,
the plan of God.
No, it's not. It's their agreement. It's their agreement.
There's and, a whole
like,
lot,
and,
right?
and like David is saying, and like we've established, now these things are amazing. Having children, getting married, these are amazing.
Yeah.
But we must know the original plan.
Yeah,
the original plan
important.
Is to exhibit the oneness we have with God.
Yeah.
Oneness means there's a relationship. There's a union. That's what we're saying. The original plan is fellowship.
Yeah.
I'd like you today to make, you know, be intentional about your life.
Yeah, yeah.
When you wake up, my dear, leave that phone. Stop scrolling your life away. Leave that phone. Have some time. Look into the scriptures. If you're looking for where to start from, I can say maybe 1 John. So that you get to know and grasp everything about love. Maybe the epistles. You can start with Romans. You can start with Ephesians. You can start with Colossians, Philippians. Look at these scriptures. Get to know who you are.
Yeah.
Be intentional about eating God's word.
Yeah. Yeah.
Be intentional about this. Know that your life is based on God's purpose for your life. This is how you can enjoy being single. And you can be single forever. We're saying that even when you are married, you can be single. Now, being single, we're saying, it's not that you're not going to get married. It's that you are married, but you are married with purpose.
Yeah.
And your eye is single on that purpose, even as a married person. You, the husband is his eyes, you know, are single on this purpose.
Yeah.
The wife, her eyes are single on this purpose. Yes, they want to know why do we have this marriage? What's God's purpose for this? So this is what really wakes you up every morning and you can do the work of God from the point of fellowship, from the point of communion.
Yeah.
So it's been amazing today.
Yeah.
And as we're wrapping up, David, I'd like to know, in your own life, you know, meditation is amazing.
Yeah.
Reading the scriptures is amazing.
Yeah.
So I'd like us to just bring out real suggestions how people can have this communion with God.
Yeah.
So I have talked about God's word. That's what we've established.
Yeah.
Looking at God's word, being intentional.
Yeah.
You can have people who, if you don't know how to do it, you can have a friend say, I'd like us to read Ephesians today.
Yeah. Yeah.
Let's look at the book of Ephesians together.
Yeah. Yeah.
You know, the person is reading chapter 1. I'm reading chapter 1. Later, we can come together and just look at summary. We summarize that scripture. Or we look at what was it for you? What did verse 1, you know, how was verse 1 for you or verse 2? So these are practical ways you can start building. You can start learning God's word. And then prayer. The place of prayer. So this series will continue it. We're establishing today that God's word is the foundation first.
Yeah.
Knowing God is the foundation first.
Yeah.
That's the foundation.
Mm.
Another time we'll expose meditation.
Yeah.
How meditation is so powerful.
Yeah.
Another time we'll expose prayer. How prayer is so powerful to you unveiling and getting to know God's original plan for you. Well, I want to believe that today you learned a thing or two.
Yeah.
David, I'm sure you learned a thing or two. Because it's not just about us talking. We're also learning. Because this is God doing his work through us, honestly. This is
God just
paying attention to him.
Yeah.
So I hope this also came off something for you. You listening to us, you single out there, married or single, we refer to you as single. Single means that your eyes are single.
Yeah.
Your eyes are single. You're focused on the purpose of God. That's what mean. That's what being single truly means.
That it drives your life.
It drives your life every day. That's what you think about. And you make intentional steps on how to grow in that relationship with God. It's beyond church going. I can can tell you, is beyond church going. It's about you even hearing things in church, and you're not even just absorbing everything. You're still taking those things home and you're looking at them through the light of scriptures.
You know, as a result of the things you're learning, it's meant to empower your heart.
Exactly.
Right?
Exactly.
Help you stay on that path of light, that path of purpose, right, on the part of knowing, right, the things that God wants you to do, right, and stay committed to them,
to him,
not just doing things in random motion,
like
Paul say, beating the air.
So right. As we're wrapping off, it's been amazing right here in the studio, and like we promise, we will keep unraveling, or we'll keep looking at steps on how one can, you know, open up, open him or herself up to his original plan. So as we're wrapping up, we hope that you have learned a thing or two. This is not us repeating ourselves, but just to say, we're signing off for Single and Full today, and we're hoping and we're praying, you know, trusting God that the eyes of your understanding may be enlightened, that you will know the hope of his calling, and when you wake up, God, I want to know you. Eternal life is about knowing God. Being single and full is about knowing God, and knowing God is knowing you. Thank you so much for being with us today, and see you next week Monday.
Yeah.